طيب، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأولين والآخرين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We continue, my dear brothers and sisters, our class, which is about explaining narrations from the book of Bulugh al-Maram. As you know, we are still in the book or chapter which is talk about business and commercial transaction. And as we said, this it's general book, and under this title, which they call it book, okay, or section, there are many chapters or sub chapters. And today we'll go to continue talking about taking something or belonging for others by force. And what's the rules regarding this? We already mentioned some of the narration last week that the person, if he made any damage or he took somebody else's belongings without right, then he should return it. Today we'll talk about another types of something that could happen. And this is mostly happened in rural area, you know, when we talk about village and towns, when people are farmers or, you know, the agriculture environment, there are some troubles that may come or dispute between people because of this matter, that some people may, they try to take advantage of the land of others, either knowingly or they don't know about this. And here some of the hadith which explain and talk about some of these issues. Let's go with the first hadith. The first hadith, and Rafi' ibn Khadij radiyallahu anhu qal, qal Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man zara'a fi ardi qawmin bighayri idhnihim فليس له من الزرع شيء وله نفقته. Now the meaning of this hadith, رافع ابن خديج narrated that the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, if anyone sows in other people's land without their permission, so that means he planted, okay, planted some plants, he has no right to any of the crops, anything or outcome of this plant that he planted, he has no right on, or any of the harvest. But he may get back what it caused him. This hadith related by al-Imam Ahmad. Now, why the Imam Ibn Hajar, the compiler of the book of Bulugh al-Maram, why he mentioned this hadith here? Because as we said, here we are talking about taking other people's belongings without their permission. So this is one example or one form that people may take advantage of other people's property without their permission and without their agreement. So here to show what is the ruling and if something happened as it is mentioned. So, you know, a person when he comes to a land which belongs to somebody else, it's not his, and he planted some plants. These plants, as you know, or taking advantage in this land, either by building a building like you know, a room or storage, or you know, anything that he put to show that he can benefit from this, or he may plant some plants or some trees. So when we talk about plant and trees, they are of two types. These trees or plants are of two types. Some, you see, they call it in Arabic zara, which is just plant without a trunk, you know, like something that always grow on the surface of the earth. It doesn't go up like trees. Okay, so this, like for example, onions, like tomatoes, like these things, always it doesn't go up, just on the surface of the land. So this is they call it بدون ساق, or without a trunk. And other plant, maybe as we said, as it with the trees, like lemon, for example, like orange, or any of these which has trunk or palm trees. Now, what's the difference between these two types? Because you see one type, which is very fast. That means you can plant it today, you can harvest, soon, and then you can take it from the surface of the earth and it will be finished. There's no sign for this. And this is what, you know, some people, they do here, you know, in our area, Jeddah around, you see the Jeddah or in this area, when rain come, some people, what they do, they go, so an open space, like a desert, it's open space. And they plant the seed of watermelon. And they know, they're expecting that the rain is coming. I mean, this is the season for the rain, rainy season. So they go, it doesn't belong to any, you know, an open area. It doesn't belong to anybody. So what they do, they put the seed of this watermelon. So when the rains come, it will grow and they can get this watermelon, they collect it, they sell it, they use it, or they eat it. So this is this time what we call it seasonal plant. Seasonal plant. That means you can plant it today, and then at the end of the season, when the harvest happened, it will be taken away. It will be disappeared. So this is an easy one. But the problem with the other one, which was trunks, with like palm trees. And because this will last for long time, which means if somebody planted in the land of somebody else, that's mean he may own it, or he tried to get, you know, to own it. And he said, this I planted for many years. Like, for example, the palm trees will not give its production or its fruit or dates till maybe take about 3, 4, 5 years before you get the harvest. So anyway, so the hadith said, here, if someone plant any type of plant in a land that doesn't belong to him, belong to somebody else, and he know that this is not his, and then the owner of this land, he come or came and he said, why did you plant in my land? I need my land. This is my land. So how, what is the ruling here according to this hadith? The one who put this plant has no right in the harvest or in the plant. So what type of rights he has? Only the expenses that he spent. If he spent some money in this, you know, he brought, for example, water. For example, he, you know, hired some laborers to plant it. So we calculate how much he spent, and then it will be given to him. So we conclude that he has no right in this farming or in this plants or this, you know, anything of the production of the harvest that he has. So this, for example, onions or whatever he planted, all will go to whom? To the owner of the land. Not for the one who planted there or sowed there. And for this person, he will be given his expenses. As it said in the hadith, if anyone sows in other people's land without their permission, he has no right to any of the crops. So he has no right in the harvest. He has no right in the harvest. And look to the condition here. It said without their permission, which means if he asks them for permission, if they agree with him, then he has a right. Why? Because he already took their permission. And maybe he was, you know, try to have some type of sharing or company with them. He said, the land is yours and the work on me. So what I will do, I will plant this land and whatever harvests come from this land, then we can divide it. For example, you can 1/4 for you or half and half or whatever agreement that could happen to them. But if there is no permission, then there is no right for him except that he took his expenses. طيب. Let's move to the next hadith. Explain that if it is long term trees or harvest. Urwa ibn Abi ibn Zuhair narrated, a man from the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a sahabi, said, two men came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam disputing over a piece of land. Two people, they came asking the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to judge between them. They have dispute in which one of them had planted palm trees and the land belonged to the other. So this person came and planted palm trees in something or land that doesn't belong to him, as we mentioned. And we know, as I mentioned before, that when talk about palm trees and nakhil, this will take long time for the harvest, till the time to, that you can get dates from this palm tree, because it takes about 4 to 5 years. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam judged that the land belonged to its original owner and commanded the other to take out his palm trees. Now, what's the difference between this hadith and previous hadith? The previous hadith, it said, if it is something simple, you know, and it will be, the harvest will be very quick, for example, there's no harm that if the owner of the land want to give him a chance and he said, well, I already, you know, planted this watermelon or this tomatoes or this, it's only 2 or 3 months, then I'll get the harvest, then it's okay. He said, okay, no problem. But, you know, you take only the expenses and leave that this for me. But if it's like this, palm trees or long-term plant, then he should take it away. He should take it away from you know, the land that he bought. Why? Because as we said, this is long term. And said, Rasulullah said, no right pertain to the one who planned the land of others wrongfully. He has no right because he is the one who came and he knows that this land doesn't belong to him. Therefore, he will pay the price of his action and what he did. Right. There's one point that, you know, which is not mentioned in the English translation. It said, لَيْسَ لِعِرْقٍ لِعِرْقٍ ظَالِمٍ لَيْسَ لِعِرْقٍ ظَالِمٍ حَقٍ, which is anything which is planted. And even says go inside, you know, because you know that the trees, the big the trees like palm trees or that's with trunks. You say their roots go down deep in the earth. And the Prophet ﷺ said, there is no place for the root. There is no place for the root that was, you know, planted in the wrong way. Right. Let's go to the next one, the next hadith. The Prophet Abu Bakr and Abi Bakr radiallahu narrated that the Messenger of Allah ﷺ said in the ceremony of farewell pilgrimage at Mina, you know, this is khutbat hujjat al-wada', hujjat or hujjat al-wada', this is the hajj, the only pilgrimage that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed in the last year before he passed away alayhi salatu wassalam. And this is the khutbah or the sermon when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam explained all the structures and all the foundation of the religion. So when this part, this is only one statement, it was very long sermon. It was very long sermon. And anyone who is interested, he can go back and read, because it was reported in the hadith of Jabir ibn Abdullah. Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhuma, he's the one who reported or described in detail the pilgrimage or the journey of pilgrimage for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from the beginning to the end. But here, this why the compiler of this book, rahimahullah, he took only this piece of the long speech, because it is related to our subject here. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "O people, surely your blood and property are inviolable until you meet your Lord." That is, it's mean prohibited. That cannot be haram. That means it is forbidden. As the inviolability of this day, as this day and this month in this land. Now look to the description of the Prophet ﷺ to show you how much it is, you know, very serious to take the right of others or insult them or take their property. So he described this or compared it to the sacred place, the sacred day, the sacred month. And it was mentioned in the khutbah that was reported by Jabir ibn Abdullah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he asked them first. He said, and before he said this statement, he said, "What day is this?" And the Sahaba, the companion, they know it is the day of Arafah, but they didn't say, you know, they said, "Allah and His Messenger know the best." They thought that he will give a different name. And this is to show you how much they were polite in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nobody come and jump and say, "This is the day of Arafah," because he knows that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knows this. But he asked this question to get their attention to that time or that day. So they said it. And then he said, "This is the day of Arafah." And then he asked them, "What month is this?" And the same thing. They didn't answer. They said, "Allah and His Messenger knows better." And they said, "We thought that He will give it a different name." And then he mentioned it is the month of Dhul Hijjah, which is one of the Al-Ashhur Al-Hurm. And then he said, "What place is this?" Which is Mina, which is in the area of Mecca, which is the boundary of the Haram, very close to the Haram. Why did the Prophet ﷺ start with this? By asking this question. And the answers are known for them. The purpose is to turn their attention about the sacred place, the sacred month, the sacred day, which is very, you know, highly respected and should be, you know, taken care of. And then he gave the point that he wants them to think about it. And he said, "Then you see, your money, your life, it is forbidden that you insult each other, you take somebody else's rights, as it is forbidden for this place that somebody do something which is not right." So this is the meaning here, which we consider it. So, and this, my dear brothers, as you see, when you talk about your blood, what does it mean, your blood? That means it's not right. It is forbidden. It is a great sin that a person, he killed. Killing is one of the serious matter. In fact, as it was mentioned in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first thing that will be judged among people at the day of judgment, when judgment starts, the first matter, the first issue will be addressed is blood. What do you mean by blood? Killing. Somebody kills somebody else. And killing, you know, if somebody kill any Muslim, as it's mentioned in the Quran, وَمَنْ قَتَلَ مُؤْمِنْ مُتَعَمِّدًا فَجَزَاؤُهُ, it is very serious, because Allah will be angry of him. He will be obeyed in the hellfire. See? So this is a serious matter. And by the way, it should be very understood that killing is forbidden for any human being without any right. What do you mean by right? That this right, either through the court, the judge, okay, through the court, they decided, or judgment against a person who is committing crime that will be executed, you know, if he killed somebody. So this is the only reason. Or somebody defending himself, or the war during the fighting. But for one, someone to go and kill anyone else, doesn't matter if he's a Muslim or non-Muslim, this is great sin. This is major sin. This is forbidden in Islam. And this is why, my dear brothers, you should be very, very, very careful about this, you know. Those people who go and kill others, or, you know, by any time, and they say because they are not a Muslim or because they be any Muslim, all what they do is wrong. Because even if there is, you know, enemy for Islam and there is fighting, this fighting, there is rules in, for the war in Islam. There is rules. What does it mean, rules? That means should be by the Imam. Only the Imam, the leader of the Muslim, he is the one who can declare war or he can sign a peace. It's not for anyone or any group to go by themselves and they kill and, you know, to make mischieving in the earth and they go insult other people just because they are not a Muslim. That's forbidden in Islam. And this is what it is. This is the real meaning of terrorists, to terrify people, to kill them, take their rights without belonging, without any rights. So here we learn the first thing, that this is a serious matter. And also to their belonging, property. For example, taking land of others, taking his, you know, anything that he owned, his car, like stealing his money, stealing anything that belonged to him. This is a serious, and this is haram, and this is forbidden, as mentioned in this hadith. Also, talk about the dignity of the person, not only materials, but dignity. What do we mean by dignity? That means her personality, insulting him by backbiting, like making accusation without right, talking ill about somebody in his back. All this is serious matter. This is haram. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ warned against when he said, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنِ الْمُفْلِسِ مِنْ أُمَّتِي or مَا تَعُدُّونَ الْمُفْلِسَ بَيْنَكُمْ, which means, what do you define the meaning of, you know, the feeling of bankruptcy, you know, the one who doesn't have anything. Bankruptcy. They said, well, the bankruptcy, as we know it, is the person who has nothing. No money, no stuff, nothing. This is a bankruptcy. But the Prophet ﷺ turned their attention and said, the one who had bankruptcy of my followers, of the Muslim, when at the day of judgment, when he come to the judgment with many, many good deeds, that's in some narrations said it's like the mountains, you see, like the size of mountains of good deeds. But then what he did, he insulted one and he took the money of somebody else and he accused or talk bad about some other people. So every one of those opponents at that day, what they will do, they will ask for their rights. And at that day, there is no currency except good deeds and bad deeds. Therefore, they will be given from his credit of good deeds. They will take from his credit till this credit of good deeds may be over. Nothing left for him. And say, now I have nothing to give away. But these people still, they need their rights. that will be taken from their bad deeds and will be transferred to his side, to his scale. And then what do you expect from a person that his scale is full of bad deeds? He will be thrown to the hell. So this is really, my dear brothers and sisters, is very important. The person, the Muslim, should be very careful, very careful when we deal with people, even one word, even one word, that bad word that you say it about somebody, even in a matter of joke. You know, some people, they are making joke of others. They say, oh, he's short. Look at shorty, he come, you know, and he doesn't know. If you say it this in front of him, you know that he will not like it. And you say it in his back. This is haram. This is forbidden. And this hadith warned us against doing all these things. طيب. Now let's go to another subchapter, which is preempting the sale of co-owner share to another. Now this is called al-shuf'a. Al-shuf'a in Arabic. Now what does it mean, al-shuf'a? That means the priority of having right over something. Which means, let's say that you have company with somebody else. You and your brother or your neighbor or your friend, you started company by buying a land. Let's say that this land costs 400,000 riyal. 400,000 riyal. You paid 200,000 and he paid 200,000. And then later on, one of you, he is not interested to continue having this land, but while the other one is still, he wants to keep it. So he put it in the market and he said, I will sell it for the same price or more or less. And somebody come from outside and he bought it for with 100,000, for example, or 200,000. And his partner, he doesn't know. And then when his partner, he came, he said, told him that I will sell this, my share, to so and so. For how much? For 200 riyals. 200,000 riyals. Then his partner said, okay, don't sell it to him. I have more right in this. I will pay you the same price that this other person will give it to you, and then the whole land will be for me. So I am your partner, and I have more right to take your share than you sell it to somebody else. This is what is called al-shuf'a. So what's the ruling regarding this in Islam? If some of them, for example, one of them said, no, I'm not going to sell it to you. I will sell it to somebody else. Even he will pay the same price. So let's go to the hadith to see how the hadith solve this issue. Jabir ibn Abdullah radiyallahu anhuma narrated, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam decreed the right of primogeniture, sorry, I don't know how to pronounce it, this word this time that's come across, right of primogeniture to a partner in every joint property, which is not clearly divided between partners. So here we have a condition. But if the boundaries of the royalty were demarked, that means it was already marked, or the ways and road were fixed, then there is no preemption. So the hadith is very clear. So you, in this land, after you bought this land, both of you, you made line between you, and you say, half this half for you, and this half for me. And you marked, everybody marked his side, then it's not necessary, you know, and this partner has no right to object or say, no, I will take it. But if it was, you know, that you share the land and no, none of you know which one is his part. Like, for example, if a person, he has a building, They own the building. Fine. And then one of them, he want to sell his share of the building to somebody else. And now we come and ask to apply this hadith. And we said, now this building, did you have an agreement between you to divide this building between you clearly? That's mean you said you take, for example, the top story and then the bottom is for you, or half of the building here, or it has four apartments, let's say, and you say two apartments for you and two apartments for me, and it was marked, and you, for example, you already officially documented which one has what part of this building or not. If the building just without dividing or without any explanation or detail to show which one own which part, then the partner has the right to buy the share of his partner. But if it was divided and everything is clear for everyone, then it's okay to sell it to him or to sell it to somebody else. طيب. There is another hadith which go and confirm this. In hadith Muslim, which is another version of this hadith, it says permission is applicable in every joint property. Every joint, that means it was mixed. Whether land, dwelling garden, it's not valid. Another version, it is not lawful for the partner to sell his share before informing his partner. So if you get into a company with somebody else and you share something, a company, a building, a land, a house, a car, whatever, and then you want to sell your share because you are in need for money, for example, the first thing before you put it in the market, you call your partner and said, look, I'm in need for money. I want to sell my share. So do you like to buy it or should I put it in the market? So if he is interested and he has money and he won't take it, then he has more right than anybody else. But if he didn't or he give you, permission to do it, then it is okay. And then the next hadith is almost the same, but here we talk about neighbors. Anas ibn Malik narrated that the Messenger of Allah said, the neighbor of the house is the one who has the most right to buy it, related by An-Nasa'i ibn Hibban and related as Sahih. You know, the right of the neighbor is very important and very high. And why the Prophet said, the neighbor of the house has more right to buy it? Because when you sell it, this neighbor may get somebody else that he will not be a good neighbor. Besides, this neighbor, maybe he wants to expand his house. He wants to expand his house. And then as long as he will pay for you the same money, the same value that you may take from somebody else, and he's your neighbor, and he has more rights, and we know how much the right of the neighbor over his neighbor, Haqqul Jar, then the Prophet ﷺ said, has the most right to buy it. So before you sell your house, you ask your neighbor around you, I'm going to sell my house. Anyone of you interested to buy it? Your neighbor, this right on the left or in the front or the back, whatever. You see, the more close is, have more right. If none of them interested, then you have the right to sell it to somebody. Stay. And the same thing, the hadith, which is narrated by Abi Rafi' radiallahu anhu, who said, the Messenger of Allah said, the neighbor has more right than anyone else because of his nearness. So the Prophet said, he's very near. Therefore, he has more right than other. The next hadith of Jabir also, it gives the same meaning. the neighbor has the most right to the mention of his neighbor property. He should be waited for, this means before selling it, even if he was absent when the two properties share the same road. If two neighbors in the same house and they, you know, the same road, and one of them, he want to sell his house, first of all, he should tell his neighbor. And the hadith said, make it emphasize that even if he was absent, I can share no trouble, then wait for him. Don't be in rush just to sell it. And then when your neighbor come from his journey and he found another neighbor, a new one, in the next house. So this to show, my dear brothers, how much it's very important in Islam to keep the unity of the community and the agreement, and to stop, you know, and cut all ways that may lead to dispute among the Muslim. The same thing also, which is next one, Ibn Umar, he said, the right of the neighbor is similar to losing a strap. That means it is very important for this. طيب, I think we stop here because we'll start a new sub-chapter, inshallah, which is called Al-Qirab, which is financing, a profit sharing venture. Inshallah, we'll discuss this a new chapter next. We بارك الله فيكم وجزاكم الله خير, and we leave some time for your question, because you know, before you go to Salat al-Isha. جزاكم الله خير, صلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد. Okay, anyone has question, you raise hand, and our جزا الله خير, our admin, the meeting admin, he will, or the admin, she will give permission to unmute your mic, then you can ask your question. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So no question. Alhamdulillah, that's mean everything, inshallah, is clear. And you still have the chance to ask your question either by sending or posting your question to the group, WhatsApp group, or you send it, or you write it in the comment window for brothers and sisters who are following us on the Facebook. They can write in the comment window their question, and we address, inshallah, in our next meeting. Jazakumullah khair, barakallah feekum. May Allah bless you all, and see you, inshallah, next week. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.